Hello students, as most of you requested, so from today onwards I'm going to start the NEET series, which is from the Abhyas mock test papers. So I will be discussing a set of questions daily, so not just telling the answer but explaining the concept behind each and every questions, so you will be finding it easy to solve such a kind of questions. Okay, if you see anywhere else you will feel very confident if you see such a kind of questions somewhere else also. Okay, so please don't skip the video. Okay, I will be discussing some 10 to 12 questions or 10 to 15 questions. Okay, so you can ask me any doubt without any hesitation. So first of all, first question. Okay, so from here onwards chemistry questions starts. So which of the following statements are correct? Okay, so CCP structures has three different layers. Okay, so what is CCP? CCP is another name for FCC. In CCP structure, first and fourth layers are repeated. In the HCP structure, first and fourth layers are repeated. In FCC packing, neighboring face-centered atoms touch each other. So you have to tell which of the statements are correct. Okay, so more than one statement is correct, so we have to find it. So before telling this, I will tell you what is CCP. I will explain you. Okay, so CCP, another name FCC, both are same. So we know that what is FCC structure, student. So we have a unit cell like this, and we have what? And we have all the corner atoms filled, and apart from that we will be having atoms at the center of each face. Okay students, so to make it easy, so I have a model. I will tell you, see, first 5 atoms. Okay, so 1 2 3 4 5 atoms. Okay, corner atoms and center atom. Okay, and this one, and you could be knowing this already. So this is the 4 atoms, the next layer, these 4 atoms. Okay, this is one layer, this is another layer, and this is the another, okay, topmost layer. Okay, so if you see like this, okay, this is topmost layer. So you may think that this is one layer, this is two layer, this is another layer. This is layer A containing 5 atoms, this is layer B containing 4 atoms, and this is layer A again 5 atoms. If you watch like this, you may think that A and B patterns are repeating. Okay, but I would like to view this CCP by a, see, we were looking from down to bottom, right? Down to bottom. See, I am asking you to view this model, view this unit cell through the corner cell. Okay, so no, don't worry, I have a model, so it will make the purpose very easily. See, this is what, 5 4 5. Okay, so I am asking you to view from this corner. So I am taking this atom out. So what do you see? You see a triangle, right? Triangle with the corner upward and the baseline downwards. So I am going to remove that triangle. Okay, so now what do you see? Another triangle with the base top and the corner down. Okay, this is another layer, this is another layer. Okay, so how many layers you have? First I took this one out, 1 2 3, and again this gets repeated again, 1. So what they say, this is CCP only, but you have to view from the corner. Okay, so CCP has three different layers, correct? CCP has three different layers, correct? 1 2 3. And in CCP structure, first and the fourth layers are repeated, right? In CCP structures, first and the fourth is what? 1 2 3. Fourth is again repetition of the first one, correct? So A and B are correct. In a HCP structure, similarly FCC, so we will check whether it is correct or not, then we will go to HCP, right? In FCC packing, the neighboring face-centered atoms touch each other, right? Correct. The neighboring This is the face-centered atoms. The neighboring face-centered atoms touch each other. That is true. Okay, so that is also correct. That is also correct. Then we will check whether C is correct or not. In a HCP structure, first and the fourth layers are repeated. What is a HCP unit cell, students? So we are having, okay, this is one layer A, and above that we will be having a three atoms. This is layer B. Again A will get repeat. Okay, so this is your HCP, one over the other. So what do they say in HCP? First and the fourth layers are repeated. So this is layer 1, layer 2 and layer 3. And what will be the fourth layer? Fourth layer is again the pattern B. Is that the in fourth layer the first layer is repeated? No, it is not repeated. This is not true. Okay, so what are the things correct? So this is not true. So the answer is, which are all correct statement? A, B and D. So A, B and D, this is the correct answer. Okay students, then volume of 0.1 molar H2SO4 required to neutralize 30 ml of 0.2 normal NaOH solution. If you see, this sodium hydroxide has been given in normality and sulfuric acid has been given in molarity. Okay, so I will tell you the way to solve this question. Okay students, so what are the things they have given? They have given, okay, 0.1 molar H2SO4 and this 0.2 normal, okay, sodium hydroxide. So students, 0.2 normal sodium hydroxide, which we are using 30 ml. For to use this formula, N1V1 is equal to N2V2, we need to change this, okay, H2SO4 to normality. Okay, see, what is normality, students? When we speak about, okay, normality, it is the chemical equivalence that react with another chemical equivalence. So what happens when you treat with sulfuric acid and sodium hydroxide? What are the reacting species? It is the reacting species from sodium hydroxide is hydroxyl ion. Okay, so what is the equivalent chemical or ion that will react? Okay, that is the H plus ions from this acid. Okay, but if you see, one mole, okay, one molecule of H2SO4 is giving two H plus. There are two H plus ions. Okay, it is one molecule of sodium hydroxide gives only one mole of, okay, only one ion of hydroxyl ions. Okay, so the VF, okay, the valence factor of sulfuric acid here is 2. Okay, so to convert, so its molarity is given, we need to convert this molarity to normality. Okay, so how to find the normality? So take this formula, students. So normality is equal to molarity into valence factor. So we found that the sulfuric acid has valence factor 2. Okay, it has 2 replaceable H plus ions. So what is the molarity already? 0.1 into 2, so 0.2. So the normality is what? So we have found out the normality is 0.2 N. okay, now we can very well substitute in this formula, which is 0.2, okay, into volume. We need to find out the volume of sulfuric acid needed, okay, equal to the normality of sodium hydroxide into 30. So we can find that V1 is also 30 ml. Okay, so the answer is what? The answer is 30 ml. Okay students, so the lanthanide contraction is responsible for the fact that zirconium and hafnium have same radius, zirconium and zinc have the same oxidation state, zirconium and yttrium have same radius, and zirconium and niobium have similar oxidation state. You know that lanthanide contraction affects only the radius and not the oxidation state. Okay, and we know, see, in the periodic table, down the group, zirconium here, hafnium, okay, yttrium is before zirconium. Okay, and we know that down the group the radius decreases, there is a lanthanide contraction. So the answer is have the same radius. Zirconium and hafnium have same radius and not yttrium. Okay, so the alkene C6H10 producing a dihaldehyde on ozonolysis. So you have to find out the starting compound which on ozonolysis gave this aldehyde. Okay, so I'll tell you what is ozonolysis reaction first of all. See, if you take any double bond, if you take any double bond, say for example, so CH2 double bond CH2, if you do ozonolysis, what happens? The double bond will get cleaved. The double bond will get cleaved completely. And instead of this double bond, what you have to do in this carbon double bond O, that's all. And there is no connectivity between these two molecules. It will break completely. So what you will get? So this reaction will yield, carbon double bond O, there is two hydrogen, one hydrogen here and one hydrogen here. HCHO, this is formaldehyde, and similarly this also, C double bond O, H here and H here. So two molecules of formaldehyde. So any molecule if you take, so CH3, CH double bond CH, this is CH3. What happens if you do ozonolysis here? This molecules will break completely split, and instead of that double bond, if you do ozonolysis, carbon double bond O. So the result is you will get two molecules of, please listen careful, CH3, C, double bond O and H. Again, this is a symmetric. So if you closely observe, there are not two molecules, but within the same molecule there are dihaldehyde at the terminal end. I will write the structure. See, there are 1, 2, 3, 4 CH2 in this molecule. See, double bond O here, double bond O, H and H. So this is the molecule which has been given. So from where it would have been formed if there is a double bond here? So the starting compound is nothing but cyclohexene. So when you do ozonolysis here, this bond will break and it would have given this molecule on ozonolysis. So you have to think the reverse. The final step for the extraction of copper from copper pyrite in Bessemer converter involves a reaction. See, you know what is the final step in the Bessemer converter? See, copper has been partially oxidized, which will give you the corresponding cupric oxide, which will react with the cuprous oxide, which will react with the corresponding sulfide. So this is the answer. So here in the diazo coupling reaction with phenol, which one will give? So we have to write the order of reactivity. So this is a diazonium salt. It is going to react with phenol in this way. See, I'll tell you, this diazonium salt, it is an electrophile, and its reaction with phenol is an electrophilic substitution reaction. So it beat any group. Let's say what I'm going to write. Let's say R. So here is your phenol. So how it is going to go? See, phenol is an electron rich donor, so it is going to supply, its para position will be enriched. It is going to give lone pair. It is going to attack, it is going to give the electrons to this nitrogen, thereby so here positive sign, here positive sign. So hereby this bond will go into the nitrogen, this will take the electrons. So the result is what? So this is basically an electrophile. This is an electrophilic substitution reaction. After aromatization, this will be the product. This is your azotide. This is your azote. They are asking which one the order of reactivity of this. Since it is an electrophile, this electrophile has to react very fast. Okay, this is an electrophile. Your azodite is an electrophile. See, this is a reaction of your electrophile. What is an electrophile, students? Electrophiles are very electron poor. They are very electron poor. Okay, so they are acting, they are asking the reactivity series. So which one will increase the reactivity? See, the presence of electron withdrawing group will increase the, okay, will increase the reactivity. Why, students? If it, see, the increase in reactivity, the electron withdrawing group, what it will do? It will decrease the stability of the electrolyte. It will decrease the stability of the electrophile. So what happens? So you know that stability for any species, the stability is inversely proportional to the reactivity. Okay, the electron withdrawing group, what it does, it even more, see, if the presence of electron withdrawing group is there, it will take the, pull the electrons even more from this electrophile. Already this electrophile is an electron poor species. Okay, so what it will do, it will destabilize, it will decrease the stability of the electrophile. So what happens, it will react very quickly, it will react very quickly. Okay, so the electron, presence of electron withdrawing group will decrease the stability and thereby increase the reactivity. So the, which is the electron withdrawing group here? The nitro is a strong electron withdrawing group here. So first reactivity is 2. Okay, first reactivity, then comes then all our electron donating groups. This is a strong electron donating group. This is a very strong electron donating group. So it will increase the stability, decrease the reactivity. So one will come at last. Okay, then comes your methoxy. It is also a very good electron donating group, but lesser than this. Okay, lesser than this. So your 3, then, okay, so the reactivity goes in this order. So methyl is also an electron donating group, but not as, only it can show the hyperconjugation effect. It donates by hyperconjugation, whereas your ammonia, okay, dimethylamine and your methoxy group are very strong, whereas this one is a very good electron donating group. So it comes last, then comes your methoxy, and then your methyl and your nitro. Okay, so 2 4 3 1. Okay, so that must be your reactivity series. So 2 4 3 1, so the reactivity goes in this order. So which of the following is an extensive property of the system? See, to solve these kind of questions, extensive property and intensive property, I will tell you a trick to follow. Okay, so what is the trick? So in your paper, okay, so write a column, write a box like this. See, you know the extensive, what is extensive property? Extensive property, it is depends upon the mass or quantity. It depends on the quantity or mass of the material or substance. Okay, quantity or mass. What is intensive property? Does not, independent, intensive. Okay, it is independent, it is independent on the mass of the material or quantity of the material. Okay, suppose this is the room. Okay, so let's solve one question. Okay, if I divide this room, okay, what will happen to your volume? What will happen to your volume? The volume will get divided by 2. Okay, so what will happen to the viscosity if this is a beaker of some liquid? If I divide that liquid, that viscosity changes here and here. Viscosity is same. Viscosity is same in both. Okay, so what happened to the temperature? If it is a room, if I divide that room into 2 halves, will the temperature change in one half and another half? No, the temperature remains the same. So what will happen to refractive index? If it is a piece of glass, if I divide the glass into 2, will the refractive index change in one part of the glass and another part of the glass? No. So what changes? Only the volume got changed. If I divide the room into two halves, the volume of the entire room get changes. Yes, isn't it? So this is the extensive property, and rest of the things are intensive property. So the answer is volume. Okay, so for extensive and intensive property, you yourself can do like this. Okay, whichever gets divided and whichever it will get not affected, like that you can check whatever they ask. Okay, so the next question: choose the correct answer about the major product formed in the E2 reaction. See students, please don't confuse yourself. So I will write the structure. Okay, so please watch it. How do I write? Okay, see, this is an E2 elimination. Okay, here the bromine is like this, and this is dotted bond, means it is away from the site. See, it is like a inverted Y, the alphabet Y. Okay, see, here the hydrogen is there, the hydrogen is there, and the dotted line, and this wedge bond, there is an ethyl group. Okay, so this is an E2 elimination which takes place in the presence of a strong base. Thereby, if the base will abstract this proton, okay, and the bromine will eliminate. But there is a criteria that the bromine and the hydrogen, which is removed in the elimination, must be in a conformer that it is exactly opposite to the bromine. So there must be an angle of 180 degree. Here that is 0 degree. Okay, so the elimination cannot happen when it is at 0 degree, but there is no problem. See, since it is an sp3 hybridized carbon, there is a free rotation here. There is this carbon and this carbon will be keep on rotating. There is a free rotation here. What you have to do is you rotate this molecule. Okay, see, this is an inverted Y only. Okay, so how to rotate, I will tell you. Do a rotation. Okay, so you have to, it is like a fan. It is towards you. This ethyl is towards you, and this is away from you. Okay, and this is one. See, the fan is having three blades. Okay, see, if you do like this, see, from this point of view, you are going to turn this. So what will happen? The hydrogen will come here, the ethyl will go here, and the methyl will come here. Okay, so I'm going to draw like this. See, keep this carbon. Okay, don't change the conformers. Okay, here. Keep as it is. Okay, we are going to rotate only this one, this carbon alone. So this is a three blades. Okay, imagine, okay, the fan. You are going to, in this angle, you are going to do this rotation, whereby this hydrogen will come here. Okay, so the hydrogen is going to come here down. Okay, the ethyl will go behind. Okay, so the ethyl will go behind, and your methyl, will come front. If you find this as difficult, what you do? You do two changes. Okay, what is the criteria? You have to bring this down exactly opposite to bromine. Okay, so do one change, hydrogen and ethyl change. Then after changing, you have to do one more change, ethyl and methyl change. That's all. Okay, so but after that, you should not remember ethyl has went behind. Okay, so if rotation is not a problem, you simply rotate. But please make sure this after hydrogen, ethyl, methyl, that should be followed. That there should not be any mistake. See, hydrogen, ethyl, methyl. If after changing hydrogen, methyl, ethyl, then the notation is different. Then you have done something wrong. Okay, so make sure hydrogen, ethyl, methyl. Hydrogen, ethyl, methyl in the clockwise direction. You check. If there is any mistake, then you have done something wrong. Okay, so we are not doing anything, not changing anything, just rotating. That's all. So in this case, what happens now? The base is going to attack here. This is the exact position where the elimination will take place. This is going to abstract the proton alone. So the two electrons in this bond, okay, will go and attack here. So this bromine is going to go with the electron. Since bromine is electronegative, it will always go with the electron. So what happens? So the remaining thing, you have to write. The bromine has went, so this is a dotted bond, so it will be away. Okay, so you then you freeze the rest of the thing. So this is the newly formed double bond. Okay, so here what happens, there is a hydrogen, okay, and the ethyl here which is away from the molecule. So here ethyl, okay, and then the new meet and the this methyl here. So what is this? This is what, this is trans. So you have to give numbering from here. This is the carbon 1, this is 2, this is 3. Ethyl have 2 carbons, right? So CH3 is so CH2, CH3, 4, 5. So this is the 2 methyls are in trans position. So the answer is trans 3 methyl 2 pentene. Okay, got it, students? Then which of the following sets has stronger tendency to form anions? See, as we all know this, to form anions, okay, an atom has to form anions, its electron affinity. Okay, its electron affinity and your electron negativity must be more. So which is having, these are electropositive elements, okay, and while comparing all these things, so nitrogen, oxygen and fluorine has higher electron affinity due to its smallest size and better electronegativity. So this is the option. Okay, so anion means it, these are extra electrons, no? So it has to attract anions, this is the atom. So to attract the extra electron, the size of the atom must be small, then only the electron affinity and electronegativity will be more. Okay, this is the necessary criteria, because these are, anion is an extra electron which we are going to accept. Okay, so the decomposition of dimethyl ether leads to the, so question number 55. Sorry students, so at this time, no, I can only take a printout of the copy, please. I apologize if there is any discomfort. The decomposition of dimethyl ether leads to the formation of methane, hydrogen, carbon monoxide and the oxygen. The rate is given by this equation. Okay, the rate of the reaction is followed by increase in pressure in the closed vessel. So the rate can be expressed in partial pressure of dimethyl ether. Okay, so they are asking what is the unit of the rate constant. Okay, this is so simple. They have given such a big story, but nothing, no, there is nothing in it. So the rate of the reaction, the rate, and this is your rate constant, and this is your, the order of the reaction is 3/2, which depends on ether. See, we know if it is represented in mole, what is the unit of rate of the reaction? It is what, moles per liter per time. Okay, if it is represented in concentration, here it is represented in pressure. So instead of, if it is, since it is represented in pressure, if it is in concentration, if it is in concentration, since it is represented in pressure, instead of moles per liter, it is just bar. Okay, it is bar per time. That's all, rate. Okay, so here for time they have given minutes. Okay, so I'm going to substitute, this is bar per minute equal to K. I'm just substituting the units. Okay, so here dimethyl ether is also a gas. Okay, so its unit will also be in what, bar, okay, to the power of 3/2. So the unit of K is equal to bar per minute. Okay, so bar 3/2. So what happens here? So bar to bar 1 to the power, okay, this, when this goes up, so per minute, so 1 minus 3/2 is bar to the power 1 minus 2 into minute. Okay, so this is what, minute inverse, sorry, so minute inverse, so the answer is 3. Okay, that's all. So here given 56, the graphite, the formation of carbon dioxide from graphite, the formation of water for the its formula. Okay, and the formation of methane from carbon dioxide and water has been given and its corresponding enthalpy. So from this we have to calculate the enthalpy required for the formation of methane from graphite. Okay, so these kind of questions are very easy to solve, students. So what you have to do, you see, take all this equation, see graphite plus, okay, so this is graphite, this is oxygen in gaseous state, and this is carbon dioxide, okay, and this is what the reaction enthalpy is equal to, -393.5 kilojoules per mole. Okay, so your hydrogen, that is gas, your oxygen, that is also gas, will give you liquid water. Okay, your enthalpy is equal to -285.8 kilojoules per mole. Okay, so this is your carbon dioxide plus 2H2O liquid. Okay, 2O2 gaseous state. So your enthalpy is equal to +90.38 kilojoules per mole. See, if you closely, so mark this as X, this is Y, and this is Z. Okay, how can you obtain this equation? This is the required equation which you need. So this is your graphite, okay, plus 2H2 gas, okay, and this is your methane. Okay, we have to calculate the del H. So from this three equations you have to get this equation. So if you closely look at this, see, if this is 1 mole of hydrogen is given, this is 2 mole of hydrogen. So you, what you have to do, see, if you closely observe X plus, okay, 2Y, okay, so if you add, these are all in what, in the reactant side, this is also in the reactant side, okay, so X plus 2Y, okay, so don't care about the rest of the things. Then your methane is exactly in the product side, okay, so then you have to add this equation. If it is in this side, okay, in the required equation it is in the product side, but in the given equation it is in the reactant side, then you have to minus, but it is, in this case it is not like that. In this equation also the required things both are in the reactant side, so just add Z. If you do this, okay, you will get this equation, okay, you can check this. Okay, so similarly what you have done, you have to do the enthalpy also. For enthalpy also, what is the value of X? X is equal to 393.5, okay, plus 2 into -285.8, okay, so plus 890.38. if you solve this equation, the energy will be -74.8 kilojoules per mole. Okay, so it's like this, students, just you can see the C graphite. So I did not multiply anything here. What I need is hydrogen, but only 1 mole hydrogen, but we need in this equation 2 mole hydrogen, so we multiplied the equation by 2. Okay, here gives methane, so here also in this equation it is in the product side, so simply add. Okay, whatever you do, you do the values also. Okay, so if you solve this, the answer is 74.8 kilojoules per. The next question: determine the solubility of silver chromate at 298 Kelvin given its solubility product. Okay, so you have to find the solubility. So first of all, what is silver chromate? These are sparingly soluble salt. So silver chromate, Ag2CrO4, okay, in the solution what happens, there are 2 Ag plus ions, okay, it will dissociate only feebly, 6CrO4, okay, 2 minus. Okay, so what will be the concentration here? See, let's say its solubility will be 2s, okay, so plus this is s, okay, See, some of the concentration, okay, will get dissolved at equilibrium. At equilibrium, okay, minus S from this concentration will give you 2S plus S. So, the chemical equilibrium reaction. So, what you have to do, the concentration of Ag plus, okay, to the power 2 into the concentration of CrO4 minus. Okay, so this is the formula. So when we write here, this concentration is almost it is solid in nature, so we can neglect this one, so we are not writing this. So what happens here, what is the concentration? Concentration is 2s, concentration is 2s to the power 2, and this concentration, okay, is s. It is s moles per liter, like that only. So here, what is this? So 4s cube. So it is given, the Ksp in the, at K equilibrium, we can write it as the solubility product. So the solubility product value is given to be what? So 1.1 into 10 to the power of 12. So S will be, S cube will be 1.1 into 10 to the power of minus 12 divided by 4, and S to the cube root of 1.1 into 10 to the power of minus 12 divided by 4. The answer will be, if you solve this problem, the answer will be 6.5. Okay, so the only thing you have to write it, so write the dissociation equation, okay, so write that along with that coefficient, okay, then write the K equilibrium, so the coefficient will come to the rise to the power. Okay, so you have to correct it, then you have to substitute the concentration. Okay, so when you do it properly, you will get the answer. So here, this is very important question, student. See, I'll tell you, if the principal quantum number is equal to n is equal to 6, the correct sequence of filling of electrons will be, okay, see, I'll tell you a trick to solve this question. See, for any n shell, what will be there? See, for any n shell, okay, the S will be the same number of n, and the P will be the same number of n, and the D will be what? N minus 1, n minus 1 level only be filled, and the F will be n minus 2. Okay, here the n is equal to 6 here. So while filling the electrons, we have to follow the n plus l rule. I'll tell you what n plus l rule. Okay, so for here the n level is given. Okay, so the n value is 6 here, and the l value, you know, for s is will be 0. So the n plus l, okay, will be what? Will be 6. Will be 6 itself. Okay, so for p, the n takes the same value. Okay, 6, the l value will be 1. So the n plus 1 will be 7 here. The n plus 1 will be 7 here. And for D, n, it takes an n minus 1 value. N minus 1 value, so it is 5. The L value will be equal to what? It is equal to 2. So here the n plus L value is 7 here. Okay, so for F, n minus 2 is taken. So it is what? 4. And the L value is 3. So here it is 7. So you have to arrange the electrons in the increasing order, okay, in the increasing order of n plus 1. What you have to do, you have to, from the lower number of n plus 1 value to the higher value. So which is just having the n plus 1 value, lowest value, this one. So your ns will be filled first. Then while coming to that, all these three are same. So how to find that? If all the n plus 1 value are same, you have to choose the value which is having the n value small. So this is having the n value small. So here the n minus 2 F level will be filled first. Okay, so this will be having the lowest energy. So this will be filled. Then your n minus 2. Again, while coming to that, which is having the least n value among these two? Your 5, your n minus 1, okay, your n minus 1 D, Okay, then comes your NP. Okay, students, you understood? You have to follow the N plus 1 rule. So the least value of N plus 1 will be filled first. So in case you have the same N plus 1 value, go for the N value which is having the least value. So accordingly, you will get the answer. So N as N minus 2. So this is the option. So these are all very important questions, students. Please note it. The valence shell electronic configuration of NS2 NP5, the element will belong to the, we know it is halogen, right? So no need to explain, I think. So students, why I'm explaining little bit slowly, so you will understand. So day by day you will if you follow my videos regularly, we will speed up. Okay, in between I'll try to help you as I'll try to put my utmost effort. That's what I can assure you. An azeotropic solution of two liquids has boiling point lower than either of them when it, so I'll explain you what it is before, then you yourself will tell me the answer. See, there are three kinds of liquids, students. See if I have liquid A and liquid B. Okay, this is what liquid A and liquid B. See, these liquids when I mix, so these liquids, they themselves will be having some attractive forces or repulsion forces. So we indicate that by AA and BB. Okay, if we mix these two liquids, okay, then there will be a new interaction. If the new interaction AB is equivalent to that of AA and BB, okay, is equivalent, all these are equal, then we call this as an ideal solution. Then when the interactions are same as before, we call it as ideal solution. And the criteria is, there will be, after mixing, there will not be any change in volume, or there will not be any change in enthalpy. Okay, this is an ideal solution. Okay, and the vapor pressure will also remains the same as before, there will not be any change. Okay, so for ideal solution, when you mix two kinds of liquids, okay, so its vapor pressure will be the additive of the two. This is normal vapor pressure. This is the, when you mix two liquids, okay, so this is what PA plus PB, just the additive of these two. Okay, so when you have to boil these two liquids, suppose to here we need a temperature to boil this one. Okay, so what is boiling? We need to separate all the interactions, we need to break all the interactions to make into independent molecules, then only it will escape into gaseous state. Okay, this is an ideal solution. So now I am going to tell you about the deviations. Okay, so this AB liquid, we are going to mix. See, here the newly arisen liquid has greater interaction than AA or BB. Has greater interaction means kind of hydrogen bonding. They have been strongly connective interaction forces. So what will happen? The molecules will come closer to each other, after mixing. So definitely the volume mixing, there will be a change in volume. The after mixing, it will be lesser than zero, because it will, more the interaction, the volume will shrink. Okay, it will not be the same volume. The molecules have stronger interaction, they will come closer to each other, so the volume will decrease. Okay, so for such thing, it will show the vapor pressure. What is, now you have to supply, see, these kind of liquids, what we say, these are showing the negative deviation. So what happens, why do we say that? See, here I told you to boil this. Okay, say the temperature T1 is needed. Since the interactions has become more strong, the vapor pressure has come down. Now to boil this, you need to supply a temperature T2 to boil it, where T2 is greater than T1. Why, students? So because of strong interaction, the vapor pressure has decreased. Okay, so you have to supply a higher temperature to boil them. Okay, so for the liquids which show negative deviation, what are the liquids will show negative deviation? Then when the interactions are very stronger than before, their vapor pressure will decrease. This is known as negative deviation. Negative deviation. Okay, so positive deviation, what happens, students, when the interaction or as a kind of repulsive than AA or BB. Okay, or what happens, they try to remain as far as possible. So as far as possible, they tend to repel one another. So what happens, that the volume will increase. So these kind of liquids, what it will show, its vapor pressure, will be greater than the previous liquids. This is known as positive deviation. Now to boil this, you need to give a temperature T3. Okay, T3, where T3 is very much, you see, the T3 is very much lesser than T1. Okay, so a very low boiling point, this will have a very low boiling point, and this will have a higher boiling point, which show negative deviations. Okay, now you understood, an azeotrope solution of two liquids has boiling point lower than either of them, when it shows positive deviation from the Raoult's law. Okay, see, which shows the lower boiling point, the positive deviation only. Okay, so now during the electrolysis, only these two questions. With that I'll finish this session. I'll meet you in the next session. During the electrolysis of water, the volume of oxygen liberated is 2.24 decimeter cube, and the volume of hydrogen liberated under the same condition will be. Okay, so first of all, water we are going to hydrolyze, so H2. Okay, when you balance this equation, so this is what, so we can say, okay, half. Okay, they told us, they have given us that the oxygen liberated is the volume, okay, is 2.24 decimeter cube, which is volume. So you know Avogadro's law, right? So what does Avogadro's law tells us? One mole of any gas will occupy a volume of 22.4 liters. They occupy equal volume. That is the thing. 22.4 is not needed here. One mole of any gas will occupy equal volume. Okay, so this is half a mole. Okay, this is half a mole and this is one mole. If a half a mole of a gas occupies 2.24, okay, one mole of hydrogen. See, what does Avogadro tells us? One mole of any gas will occupy equal volume. Okay, so if a half, this is also gaseous in nature, this is also gaseous in nature. If a half a mole of oxygen gas occupies 2.24 decimeter cube, okay, one mole of hydrogen gas is liberated, which will be twice this amount, which will be 4.48 decimeter cube. So the answer is 3.448. It's very simple. Okay, the final product formed when methyl amine is treated with NaNO2 and HCl followed by hydrolysis. See, this is a diazotization reaction, but it is in a aliphatic amine. This happens. So aliphatic amine. So what happens when NaNO2 and HCl, okay, is simply the diazonium salt which is formed. This is very, very unstable. So soon after that, even without water also, okay, it will become turn into methanol. Okay, it is that aromatic diazonium salt only, we will do many reactions, treating with copper chloride, we will get chlorobenzene, like that. Okay, so it will give you methyl alcohol. Okay students, I hope this helped you to some extent. So please tell me your comment, so that I will get motivated, or whatever you think, please please open without any hesitation, you can share with me. Okay, meet you in next video. Thank you.